I am a local representative and also a vice mayor of District 11, which is the largest district in Budapest. It has 150,000 people living in it, and the municipal elections were in 2019, which is, I think, an important point in time, because that's when many mayors who belong to opposition parties took power in the district, in the municipalities of Budapest and in many larger cities in Hungary, and that's when transparency became a more important topic in these local municipalities compared to previous years.
I'm Lucian Mija. I'm, as you said earlier, the advisor of the mayor from our city. Our city is called Făgăraș. It's a 30,000 inhabitants city situated in the middle of Romania. So 1 year ago, when the coronavirus pandemic started, we were connected to the whole world. So we had a few time to prepare, luckily. So additional to the information we had from the media, from what happened in Lombardy and then in entire Italy, we had information from many of our relatives and friends who live there. It's a large community of people from our region. The pandemic has affected the work of local administration in many ways. First of all, the revenues from taxes and duties, as well as those from the taxes paid by the workers, decreased a lot. Many of the activities temporary was suspended. All this combined with an increase of spending due to the coronavirus crisis. So the local administration had to pay more for quarantine centers, for hospital spendings. However, the city continues the work, because most of our projects are financed from European funds. In addition to all the negative things that the coronavirus pandemic brought to us, there are some positive ones. The pandemic has accelerated the digitalization of the administration, of the local administration. So now many of the services that we provide to our citizens are online. At the same time, the almost two months of the first and the only lockdown in our country permitted to the city to take a break and to breathe, as well to the entire planet. So after that, nature blew something last spring in a way that it has never done it before.
I wanted to start with this caveat that I'm not a local government insider, in the sense that I'm not working in the local administrations, but rather I'm doing research in this field. I work as an assistant professor at the University of Warsaw, and at the same time I'm an expert at the Stefan Bantore Foundation, which is also dealing with local democracy and the quality of local democracy. This is particularly field of my interest. So of course, obviously, we are monitoring what is happening with local governments during the pandemic. We can see that pandemics refocused the attention of the general public from the central to from the local to the central arena. Actually, local issues sometimes achieving the main agenda in media and also in public opinion lost significance, and the most important decision makers are located in the central government. So it, of course, is also a centralization of the public opinion and of the message available in the nationwide media. So it actually minimizes or reduces the significance of local politics and also local democracy in a broader sense. In Poland, we observe many tax exempts, which are legislated by the central government, but without recompensation to local governments. So they really diminish the stream of funds going to local governments from the subsidies. Another example is related to the rigidity of regulations concerning debts. Well, it's clear that as central governments now in across Europe try to increase the debt by issuing the special bonds, et cetera, et cetera. But at the same time, in Poland, I'm wondering whether it's also the case of other countries in the region. In Poland, it does not lead to the loosening these criteria for local governments, which are also in a situation requiring additional funding and financial needs. This is the end of my presentation. Actually, a very meaningful slide, in my opinion, demonstrating the increasing dependence of local governments on so-called earmarked grants. So the grants which are going from the central level to local level, and they are not, they cannot be used freely by the local authorities. But they need to be assigned to specific purposes. And of course, the difference between 2015 and 17 is related to the very broad program supporting families, which was introduced by the new government. So this is the reason why this increase appeared between 2015 and 17. But actually, you can easily see that it is still increasing. And what we expect in 2020, when the data is available, is that these bars will be actually even higher due to the fact that this grants going from central government actually try to recompensate the loss of the taxes, but in fact they are recompensating it in a very biased way. So this is I think the main conclusion from the research, which is still in progress, but actually I think this is emerging as a very solid conclusion, is that the COVID actually increased decentralization tendencies in Poland. That some of the local governments very quickly went digital transferred to a lot of activities to the internet. And we observe that this actually provokes the engagement of citizens. But of course, well, it's rather, I think it's still treated as a kind of emergency option, not a way to not a standard way of having dialogue. But I think that maybe some of these modes of communication established during the pandemics will remain also after. And that would be definitely something which would be probably a best illustration of what we call resilience, that, after the crisis, we try to keep all these positive things which happened in response to crisis and to ameliorate the situation which was before. When you look at the relation between local government and citizens, in this respect, I would call them not only citizens, but also consumers, because, the local government is responsible for providing very crucial public services. And, the general picture is that during the pandemic, the quality of these services decreased in many fields. We have a lot of scattered observations that it may also rise a kind of discontent of citizens as consumers, that their expectations towards services delivered by the local governments are still present, and it is very difficult for local governments to meet them. So I think that this is also something missing, because when we see when we discuss the relation between citizens and local government, usually our first thought is it's about participation. But I think it's not only about participation; it's also about public services.
I think that access to information and the effectiveness of the communication flow is much better since we have these online events, and I'm sure that the pandemic served as a catalyst to as Adam mentioned at the beginning of his presentation, from moving to from solely offline events to at least partly online events.
I think and I hope that the digitalization in public administration is a one-way street. So I think we will now not go back to what we had before the pandemic. This is a good thing in many ways, but also I hope we will come back to the debates with the citizens in front of them. I think they are more productive.
In the first wave of the pandemic, we set up a call center where people could ask any question about the illness, about the availability of kindergartens, and we needed a lot of people in these call centers, and citizens did help us to run these facilities. So in that respect, you're right. So monetary contributions, maybe not so much, but in terms of human resources, they are more willing to help. That's true.
I was just wondering about this mobilization and engagement. And in fact, my observation is that it was much more visible in the first wave of the pandemics. So last year at the beginning, when this was also a new topic, and a lot of things were unknown. So we observed mobilization of non-governmental organizations, also in this field of, you know, supporting the healthcare system with assistance, also financial, and also subnational governments at all levels, so municipalities, counties, and regions, reallocating even symbolically, but reallocating funds for the healthcare, which is constantly underfinanced, and that is probably something which is common to many countries of our region. But it was somehow symbolic. But at the same time, I still think that local governments did not succeed in capitalizing these successes, this engagement. What do I mean? I think that it was crucial also for the, you know, for the image of local government to demonstrate the action and the engagement in the crisis. And I think that it was very quickly taken over by the central government, and all this I would say spectacular successes, but at the local scale in the particular communities were not sufficiently visible for the people. So in my opinion, I think we a bit lost the chance to demonstrate that actually a decentralized country is probably stronger to deal with the crisis like that. And this message of, you know, centralized crisis management is still prevailing, I think.
So we did do many things with which we could demonstrate that the local level is an effective level of managing local issues. And also, I think, like in Hungary, the schools belong to the central level or are managed on the central level, and the kindergartens and nurseries on the local level. And I think that the way parents could see that these services are managed on the local level, I think from that they could also see that the local management works better and communication works better than in the case of centrally organized schools. But you are right in the sense that I think municipalities could have done a lot more throughout the entirety of the pandemic. But also, I mean, they had a very difficult time. The budgets had to be readjusted every I don't know, 4 weeks, basically. And since, like, due to this very, very weak communication and cooperation between the central and the local level, I think municipalities also lost some of their power to demonstrate that they can in fact manage things better than the central level.
But first of all, that is a common experience. So it also opens the possibility for learning from different contexts. And this is probably an experience for local administrations in many countries. So I think that it is also probably the time where this flow of information of different practices just begins. I'm still thinking about the future and about the prognosis concerning the way it develops. And I think that a lot depends on the recovery funds and the way they will be distributed in the European Union and in our countries. And I think that it would be a crucial thing for the future of decentralization also. To what extent these recovery funds, to what extent also local authorities will be engaged in this in the distribution and, you know, design of these recovery funds. But in the long run, I think that the pandemic has a transformative power also for local administration. I believe that we will still have a lot to research on that.
What we must learn is that the health system is very important. So a crisis like this can hit us again, maybe sooner or later. So we must prepare our hospitals to be bigger, better, more specialized, more doctors. We must be prepared for this. We can use the recovery funds, yes, to build new hospitals or extend the ones we have. I think small communities like ours are more united. The people understood what is important. They are more united, as I said. More willing to give, and I think this is the most important thing that we achieved from this period.
In the long run, this health and economic crisis can actually bring citizens closer to local municipalities, or it can force municipalities and local authorities to go closer to citizens and be more accessible to the locals, and also to be more efficient in budgetary terms. So if anything, then these are the most important positive takeaways